Talking about architecture, human behavior, and does it affect our senses? So eventually, I mean, this is something which has always come to us. It's always been a part of us. We've just never really spoken about it, never really written about it. So here we're kind of doing an entire like a discussion where we have Mr. Prashant over here, then we have Sonia, then we have Utpala, then we have Bhavya, we have
Rahul,
and then we have Amit over here. So, I mean, we're just going to talk about the facts of how it affects us on a day-to-day life and how things can change for us in terms of being robust or being just moving around things. So in architecture, there's a saying, and the psychologists have said that we shape our buildings and afterwards the buildings shape us, which is always how it is. I mean, either we design to our space or we eventually design ourselves into the space. It's either one of them. We adapt into it. So, I mean, talking about this, we can move forward and we can actually put some questions together. Which
is about senses. I feel we as human beings are actually very sensory creatures. And it really affects us, our environment, you know, where we stay, where we work. So the compatibility with our own workers or the compatibility with your family, as well as your own relationship with yourself, is so much, you know, sensory related. It's like architecture is not, I feel, it's not just about a functional box that you're staying in where, you know, there's a bathroom and there's a living room and there's a bedroom and stuff like that. But it's all about the senses, the five senses that you all know. It's like, we all know about it, right?
Yeah.
It's like the vision and the hearing and the taste, smell, sound.
Yeah, I think it creates a first impression, all the senses, immediately when you walk into a space.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So that's what, I mean, when you have space, like a zen space, can you get a zen feeling? I think it's a lot about senses that we're talking about.
And eventually creates memories.
And as creators,
totally.
As creators, the senses
it creates memories, it rekindles our memories.
Yes. Yeah. So as I think as creators,
gives you comfort level, it makes you feel at home sometimes, you know, workplaces also. You need that feeling of belonging. Now even your decor can give you that, you know.
So
absolutely.
So coming to that home, how do you make a space feel like home?
It's very individualistic.
Yeah.
For each person, home means something different, you know. For me, it might be something that I go back to and relax. For somebody who's been in the house for a long period of time, wants something to kind of feel rejuvenated and something inspiring in the space to stimulate the senses, you know.
Sure.
So for each individual, it's different. And each family works differently in unison.
Mm-hmm.
So it all depends on, you know, what the family function is, you know, how they react to each other, how they relate to each other, and then we can take from there and transform the spaces accordingly.
I think in a more generic fashion, if we look at it, individualistic is one thing where we look at smaller pockets, but looking at essentially how you know, architecture can actually make a huge difference, we have to look at a volume. We have to look at how exactly can we, you know, as architects, can orchestrate design and leave a footprint out there, because essentially that is something which is going to drive the generation. Most importantly, the rural areas will also be well aware of the facts of the lifestyle. So overall, if I look at it, I think we have to look at triggering all the senses while we design. I think that is what I strongly feel, because otherwise we all can individually speak of our design genres, but this is something which is a very generic way of looking at how architecture can actually touch.
But isn't it also a very subjective issue?
Absolutely,
what is
it is.
Beautiful for you is not for someone else.
Absolutely, yeah. And that's when the cultural, social, and political condition is involved.
Once there was a crow nest built right in my, you know, window. So after everything was done and the birds had flown away, I thought of just, you know, kind of getting rid of that because it gives me a little more space in my window.
Mm-hmm.
So I carefully started, you know, removing things, and the first top layer, which was probably most easy to touch to the baby crows and whatever, the birds. So it was very soft. It was made of very soft fiber, you know, thing, very carefully detailed, you know. And then, okay, once the first top layer was off, there were thick twigs, you know, which would take the weight. After the thick twigs were gone, there were actually, know, tar and, you know, the salia and all of those kind of heavy metal reinforcements,
sure,
which were literally used to, you know, bind within the entire grill. So when they can be so sensitive and they know what they are doing, of course, as humans, what he is saying is absolutely right, that as humans, we have the instinct for food, water and shelter by default. So shelter is what we are actually talking about, and we are talking about getting our own comfort and get, you know, maybe we are not good at expressing, but everybody knows at the bottom of their heart what they really feel comfortable about.
Maybe I beg to differ sometimes. It depends on the kind of people you're dealing with. Now, there are some, I generally feel that, as you pointed out, sometimes clients really don't know what they
what
want.
They want.
They really don't even know what is a dream house that they're looking for. And they are looking for something which is more, you know, they want us to simplify, and they're looking up towards us to give them something like magic.
They come to us for rescuing them.
Absolutely.
And so we should have,
so when I talk to them, like, you know, there was this client, he's like, I want something like, wow, fantastic. So I said, okay, I mean, he understands senses. So I'm like, how do I get this across? So I said, okay, you go and see the Eiffel Tower, you've traveled, you're, you know, you're rich. So you go to Eiffel Tower, it's like a, you know, nice iron and that kind of a thing. It looks ugly mostly to many people.
Mm-hmm.
But the minute you light it up, it's like magic.
Yeah.
Yeah. So for me, that's what I want to do for you. Or when you go to, you know, you go to the ocean and you actually put your, you know, I mean, in the sand, you put your legs.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I want you to feel, you know, on Absolutely. Your legs, on your body. The sense of touch, the sense of intimacy, you know, the sense of the nature
Comfort.
When you're actually walking, or when you dip your legs into a lake, you know, and you feel the cool thing, or when you're walking on cobbles, or when you're walking on grass.
Then
so that's what he understands.
So
know?
Taking that forward, can you guys tell me, like, individually, how is there a way y'all have actually catered to the fact that how do y'all, I mean, work around each of the senses around over there? I mean, has anyone actually worked? Looked into that
absolutely
as a house.
All the time. Yeah. All the time.
Do that all the time.
Sure.
All the time.
I mean, any specific small, like any one thing which everyone's probably done which has made a lot of difference?
Every small thing, right from the material that you touch on the floor to the light to the music that you hear.
Absolutely.
Yeah, the first brief generally, when a client gives us is generally the color palette. They are very clear about
visual.
The color palette.
Sure.
Even if they're not sure, there's no easy thing for them, but beyond that they're not clear.
Yeah.
And the second thing they understand is their comfort level, basically. So after that comes, we say, okay, we'll give you the wow factor and we work around the dreams. But colors are very important. So
see, till four senses, I think we are kind of very much, when
sorted.
It comes to taste, it kind of
you have to, does your mouth actually water when you see rust on iron?
No.
Yeah, it happens. You know, when I see that, I mean, push to aisa, you know, as a watery, something happens, you know. So, yeah, maybe that's taste if you call it.
Talking about a place where things are a little different here. So, how do you think these, so who are we designing for? Are we designing for the people living here? Are we designing for people who are expecting to be here? But there are these people are still going to be here. Where did they go? How do, what landscape
True.
Do we create for them?
Okay, that's a very good question. So again, coming back to the senses, I think architecture and design is almost dominated by our visual sense most of the times, right? We always judge anything in context to design. Okay, right, precisely. Now, what he asked is this premises must be absolutely, you know, the architect must have justified his role by, you know, using every square inch of FSI. But if you're talking about a very honest practice, then we should also consider all the aspects, which means the infrastructure of the city, the surroundings of the city, all of those things essentially are very important to be considered. So that is what I'm trying to talk, that it shouldn't happen that only there's one piece of block which is there, but then the surroundings are not taken care. Of course, we won't be in a capacity to take care of all of that, but at least we should be well aware, and we should at least put a thought through it that, okay, this is what I can do or I can justify by proposing one design that may be rejected. But at
so
least
then
I'll feel.
We're talking about functional creativity. So, where the function is important, the creativity is important, and you merge them and be bold about it and create something really beautiful.
In the last couple of years, I believe that with this kind of exposure which everybody has over the smartphone, you know, people are more smarter now, people have access to information and access to the information all over the world. So if you understand now, lately, in the last couple of years, that the responsibility of an architect, designer, as well as the promoter, is really gone up in a much better manner. People are taking steps. The developer is also ensuring that he wants a space which is just not a building. He wants to invite, he wants to sell the property. Whereas the architect and the designer, they also feel that they have to create some kind of stimulus which is different from the other, which is giving a better perspective to the buyer or the user. So I see that in the last few years now, there is a lot of responsible design which is coming in, and lot of response from the developer who are even doing it. And so yes, using
well said, now we think about environment.
Sorry, every square inch of FSI which an architect has to use. I mean, he's at a gunpoint, please understand.
Yeah.
He has
agreed.
So there, and
do you want to, like, recently in any of these applications, do you want to name something which has actually been taken care of well by an architect and a developer?
Oh, yeah. I mean, you can see there are all new projects which you see which have been launched have got fantastic landscape, beautiful foyers. I mean, if you look at it, they really want you to come and experience, and that everybody needs that global experience now, you know. So like, if you may not have a Manhattan kind of a situation here, but people still want
you
that. But once you get into, you feel that bit of Manhattan.
But even Godrej one is fabulous. Even Godrej one.
It's just not modern.
The minute you drive into Godrej One, as in
the Crowley, right?
The Crowley.
So Godrej is an ideal example when you talk about how architecture design, because they have the, I mean, they're not
they have the luxury
every square inch of land.
See, close to home, when we talk about even public spaces, like, you know, we have the Portuguese, you know, the church.
Yeah.
It is, I mean, I was just coming through from that road, and I think it's spectacular the way Mr. Kuria is dealing with it.
That's
right, from every inch being used, you know, the correct lighting coming up, that spirituality, and It's got people, every, you know, coming to the masses, and people love it. And it is all structured in our area. Another is like the lovely Hare Rama Hare Krishna temple, which you see in Chuhu. Again, the aura, you know, because of the pure white marble and the way the whole thing is completely done up, or the Baha'i that you can see.
Sure.
I think we Indian architects are actually doing
Absolutely.
Our bit of, you know, getting our creativity
and
in.
As you were saying, there is a huge design awareness now.
Absolutely.
Team with a functionality and everybody's comfort and all. So people are making efforts towards that.
You do not forget, again, the climate in our country is so different than what you would see in New York and all. We may probably compare ourselves to Singapore or maybe Bali, which is more sensory, more, you know. I mean, Bali is totally not a very economic, money oriented business. Everything is just resorts and hotels and leisure. So I think Bali is one of the most beautiful examples, probably from my end, which I feel is luxury sensory that I would want to go to, you know. So I think that's what probably we can aim at, to bring in a little bit of the nature.
So you would go to Bali for what? Would it be for
My senses, for my for rejuvenation.
So fair enough. So that no.
Yeah, I mean everything. I enter Bali and I feel rejuvenated. I see the sculptures.
It's all about feeling good, feeling fresh.
Now we can do it here, right here in Bombay. I mean, you create spaces.
Again,
whether it's your workspace or your residential spaces.
Even control of population.
But making workspaces, like, you know, more comfortable, because half the time in Mumbai, people are spending more time in offices.
Yeah.
So as she was saying, that feel at home feeling definitely has to be there.
Yes, but all these spaces are, I mean, you have that luxury of space, you have the luxury of, you know, working on it with your senses, XYZ, but how do you bring it to your day-to-day life? I mean, how often? I mean, we can take a break once in 2 months, once in 3 months, once a month. But why can't we do that on a day-to-day basis? And how as architects, how as designers, can we actually address this issue? How can we address this and actually act upon?
I can cite one example. In Calcutta, there is a very good location, which is, again, I don't know whether we can name that, but it's Eco Space.
Yeah.
Eco Space is very near to the airport.
Mm-hmm.
And it's basically a commercial complex. And the moment you enter into the gate of that eco space, you realize the potential of what the architect has really done to that entire project. The moment you get into each and every building, or the open spaces, or the connecting spaces, or the entertainment areas, it is so brilliantly designed. I got an opportunity of doing a couple of projects out there, and I love to be there, you know. I used to keep my meetings there throughout the day. I would just not want to get into the city. I would call my contractors there in the cafe, be there. Why? because it touched all my senses. The aroma around, the landscape around, the feel around, the visual around, the colors as which has been used. And I could also sense that people who are there are so happy to work there.
Absolutely.
So that serene atmosphere has been created out of a land, a plot, which is a building design. So I believe that, and again, it is not such a huge space, or you know, they don't have a large mass of land. It has been done within a specific area. So again, as I understand that, if you get an opportunity and a freedom, and you have a client who understands that yes, you want to create something which is, you know, connecting.
No, I think we need to create those kind of places in our own cities, you know.
But it is there.
Instead of going to other cities,
responsibility as a whole.
I would
in our workspaces, in our everyday spaces.
But
and
it is
that's
there.
What
if you look at all these new projects which all these new developers have launched lately, go and have a look. I feel that yes,
yeah,
things
think
are
some
really
great
evolved,
work being done.
And yes, there is a conscious detailing which is now happening, which you just cannot miss out.
But don't you think this discussion today itself is a social responsibility that we are talking about?
It's a fact.
Yes.
So my point now, see, I'm telling you, I'm sure everyone is doing very well here in their own practice. But see, the point is, luxuries can be experienced by the rich and people who can actually spend money. What I'm talking about is, when I give examples of any other countries, purely is, you tell me how many art galleries do we have in Bombay? And if so, how many families plan that, okay, let's go to an art gallery this evening? Tell me. Okay. Now, the point is, I also am a visiting faculty of a design school, and the kids, they bring thesis, some, you know, really luxurious hotel project or some resort or some multiplex and things like that. Why not an art gallery, which is a national and civic pride? Why not try and see? These are the things that we need to talk, is because what happens is, if there's an art gallery say around the corner, it's a building by itself, it's a monument by itself. People who cannot even spend will at least experience it standing outside on that street. Now this building here is not doing any good to anyone who's there outside. Let me be very candid here, okay? Now this is what we are talking and discussing right now, is the social responsibility as architects. Now of course, by just talking and discussing, no one is going to really give me a project that, okay, go, you know, design an art gallery. I understand. But at least, you know, I think we can at least discuss, talk, you know, lay down some ideas, put it on social media as what people are going to be doing right now. So frankly, I think those things will ignite the senses of the local people on streets, and even they will understand the lifestyle factor, which in India is yet to evolve.
Correct.
So when we talk about lifestyle factor, agree to the fact that you can't, I mean, why does a person, I mean, why doesn't the student come back with an art gallery or X? I mean,
that was just an example.
No,
yeah.
I'm just saying,
yeah,
that's fair enough. So what happens is, end of the day, we are all living in an urban city, where we don't have too many options. Yes, there are a lot of people today, if you ask me, have actually moved to Goa, people have moved out of the city who cannot fit in here, and they're happy about it. The point is, why not create that social awareness in the city? How does our behavior, I mean, our architecture, culturally, socially affect us also? When you today as a developer, where we talk about a developer in, say, I'm not being a communal, I mean, nothing to do with communal stuff, but I'm just talking about, like, so there's a church and there will be Christians living around there, or there is going to be a mosque somewhere and you're expecting Muslims to live around there. And you'll actually have a developer telling you that this is my client and this is the kind of people I'm looking at. So how do you think that, I mean, how much of this does affect our architecture and our design together?
Developers are the biggest villains, I feel. Today I just went to an antique shop somewhere with, you know, to pick up a lovely sake basket, which was made by these typical, you know, Muslim guys who have a small shop in Chor Bazaar. And as you all must be aware, the Chor Bazaar is going to be broken down and the developers are going to have some multi-billion whatever stuff happening there. So like, imagine, I mean, when you walk into Chor Bazaar, it's like a sensory experience in itself. You know, going through the antiques and seeing those things, and now it's like,
and imagine that same, yeah, imagine that same shop on 20th floor.
And you know what he told me, madam, hum log ko, I don't know whether I should mention this, but we have been given huge amount of money for getting out from
there.
So like, of course, we all want that money, so why not?
But this is also a social factor, right? Maybe, yeah, so if you're walking into the Chor Bazaar lane, but if you had to drive past the lane which is parallel to it, you wouldn't want to. And every time you drive past it, you will see like, what is this? Where
why can't we create a pedestrian small street like how we have in Singapore, Hong Kong?
You can, but then that's the thing. So that today, you have the government which needs to depend on the developers to do something.
But if you ask me, since I know a couple of, few of them, they come to my office from that location. They're so happy about it.
They're very happy.
Reason is that they are going to get better platform to stay. The living conditions are going to be much more better. Okay. So things will have to evolve.
Absolutely.
You will have to allow the Chor Bazaar to go.
There will be,
and there could be a time limit. And trust me, they are now this project has been delayed for more than 5 years.
Yes.
Yeah.
Or maybe more than that.
It's been going on.
Okay. Because apparently I happen to know the promoters also. Okay. Very closely. Not for any business interest, but I know what are they trying to do in those areas. Mm-hmm. Trust me, when that happens, the city of Mumbai will have a different charm altogether.
Absolutely. So when we talk about Manhattan,
these projects are coming so late, or they are getting delayed by the system. Not now; it's been over the ages. But it is not easy for even the developers. There are so many do's and don'ts through the corporations which they have to go through, and if that happens. You will have a different Mumbai city altogether.
But you think the people living there, their behavioural patterns are going to change? You think their lifestyle is going to change?
Yes, absolutely.
It won't change hugely. Yeah. The reason is because they have not seen the sun shine in their house.
Absolutely.
Okay. So they have not sensed it. Mm-hmm. They don't have the air which is coming in. So they have not sensed it. But now with these things coming up, they will have better...
Basic sanitation.
And that is the reason that you find sort of rage, anger, frustration amongst people. The moment this happens, you will see that really changing in a much better way.
In architecture itself, what do you think? Do you think it's actually happening? Is
Absolutely.
If given a chance, I think everybody would get into green architecture, really. No, you know, they would have natural materials.
So if you all are working with developers, how many chances have you got or have they let you release? So other than the fact
we have literally managed to I would not say brainwash, but kind of educate the client to a certain extent. We've been doing a couple of projects with them in the last 3-4 years now.
Sure.
And finally, in this 7th or 8th project, we've convinced them to have a rainwater collection pond kind of a thing.
Yeah.
We've kind of convinced them to have solar lights on the street lights. Not panels as the moment, but yes, we've suggested that also, but we are going to kind of bring that also into the next phase of the project. But yes, these plus adding local materials, bringing in local materials, local labor, that is what we've brought in. So yes, there are developers who are willing to take that one next step also, not just to probably contribute to the environment, but as we kind of sell it to them that, you know, this is a fantastic approach now, and people, young generation today would want to be a part of this kind of a project. That is kind of their way of selling.
To the economics
their way of selling.
But
the
that
product.
Is again what you're talking about is a new building.
Correct.
How do you socially, how do you act like an entire, like say today as a community, we want to make Kurla as a green area.
Okay.
How does somebody actually do that? Is it actually possible? So putting one green building, is it changing a behavior pattern of somebody? Is it changing the way you think? As a person, if you're entering in today, I mean, there are enough buildings with LEED certifications and all, which probably developers are using for the fact of getting...
Marketing.
No, it's not. Marketing is one bit of it. You have some levies you get from the government as well. But does it actually affect you on a day-to-day basis? Does the efficiency level change? Does anything to do with your lifestyle move around?
I think the maintenance of a green building is a little more
higher,
efficient, or whatever you would want to call it. Of course, yes, higher. But that is what should be the aspect, that the maintenance should be low. That is what should be done. But if a green building demands a higher maintenance, then of course it's no good to kind of, you know, design a green building just for the certification purpose and then, you know, eventually add up the cost of maintenance to the end user. That kind of does not make any sense to me.
If you talk about Vastu, the green is the green section of human behavior.
Right.
Because
that's
where you start off with everything. It's basically your life.
Right from orientation.
Everything. That's how your life is going to be. So doing Vastu is, so Vastu Shastra actually is just your science, but anyway, how it affects you on a day-to-day basis will change. It will make you think.
It's very difficult to follow it every time, everywhere, like in an apartment where the next door neighbor.
See, that's a pocket we're talking about.
Yeah. So see, as I'm saying is, we don't have to just aim at the luxury. Okay, for a luxury, for a villa, I can say, okay, you turn this whole thing and you can make it like this. But what do you do to a guy who's got a small apartment?
No,
I have this one client, he's like, please change the position of the commode. I mean, how can you do that?
But you rightly mentioned the actual crux, you know, vastu, everything revolves around it, because your orientation is right, and based on that, your complete, you know,
the position of a pot, mm-hmm. in terms of vastu shastra, is in a specific way for a reason, because there used to be sunshine. So earlier you used to obviously not have
that's
those.
That's right. When you talk about apartments, in one high rise, when all the bedrooms are facing the same side, you're saying that all the beds should be in one direction.
That you're talking of an apartment. We are talking of green buildings. When you get to design a building.
Okay. Design a building. I'm talking about designing a
township project.
Yeah.
Or maybe a housing project.
Yeah. Then it's a different thing altogether.
Then holistically you can look at these aspects, which will eventually be very efficient for various reasons, right? From your air, light, all of those things will be taken care of, you know.
Coming to the new social age where everything is all about whatever looks great, sells. What do you all have to say about that? How do you think that changes your behavioral pattern now? We're looking at pictures, you're looking at Instagram, you're looking at Pinterest, and everything suddenly is getting designed from there.
Yeah.
Every client has
everything
a design
is
of
the
control.
I've literally banned Pinterest from my office.
It's very different.
People are so restricted, they don't want to think, you know.
But that's what technology is done to us. You're talking
about
actually
smartphones.
We didn't
have Google in our time.
You were looking around, you were actually seeing things, you were observing things. Suddenly you do not have the senses anymore.
No, but it gets into you somewhere. Yeah. You know, all that internet, that Google and those pictures and Instagram, it does get into you, no matter how much you want to avoid it.
It's called addiction.
It's not just about addiction, but it's just so much in the, now not even the background, it's like a foreground. It's on your face everywhere.
Well, you can always avoid it. I mean, keep your phone away.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see.
I'm
that.
Serious. No, like, you keep your phone away. You
but how do you avoid it when your client's phone away?
Yeah.
But
five different totally contradictory ideas about the same space.
So that's exactly
and
what
this
call that.
Client. We're not saying get inspired by
you
this and give me
how you want to design.
Give me exactly this. What I'm showing you. So what do you do
yeah,
then?
Yeah, they come
so
up with all
we
that.
We need to tell them as artists, this is not what we do.
Yeah.
We're not contractors. We don't make designers. And that's
when we have
a responsibility to it. Yeah.
So I be a little
look at
blunt.
The creative.
I think it helps us being
creative.
How
do you deal with it?
I am blunt, no, completely blunt, no
okay.
for this.
Straightforward, we tell them that this is not what we do.
And we do it softly.
We do it nicely, and I think it helps us become more creative, because we have to do something which is different than what is on Pinterest. So
no, but it's also other point. On the other side, it's actually helped us in the sense where you initially started off saying that clients don't know what they want. They actually
everybody knows everything. It's
no, they know what they want to see. They at least know what they something that can be done. So they probably know that this is what I like. So please take it forward from
that's something
so technology, when you know, like for example, if you say give your team, you design. So that design, you design and you just leave that person completely on their own. They're bound to use technology, they're bound to go to that printers, they're bound to do, you know. So instead of doing that, rather engage them, rather bring them on the platform, discuss, sketch out. I completely encourage all my team members to have a pencil and a measure tape in their, you know, bags, because many of the times they don't want to sketch. They've just lost
they
that touch.
They also become lazy also.
They've lost that touch of pencil. I mean, they give me those handover those 0.5 pencils, and I just completely refuse to touch them, you know, because it does not give me that feel. It does not give me that sense. So only and if I have a wooden pencil, then I will sketch and talk to you. Otherwise, I don't. So you know, it kind of at a subtle level brings that thought to them that yes, this is what. How we should be also starting to design, or how we should be engaging into that design aspect. Similarly, like giving a tablet or a phone to the kid becomes simple and easy solution for a kid to handle a kid, you know, for a while. So you instead of engaging that kid into that activity or bringing them into, you know, that like for example, I'll just share a very interesting thing. A photographer was on the site, he was shooting, and we had a kid. And of course, he was client's kid, so I could not even control him beyond a point. So the photographer came up with a fantastic idea. He came up with a fantastic idea. He said, okay, I have this tablet. You have to help me out. You are my assistant for the day. You hold this tablet like this. I am holding the camera and you just hold it like this. The kid was fantastically smooth with him because he had a task to be done. You know, he was given a responsibility. So the minute he's given a responsibility, it's all sorted out. But the minute you kind of shoo him away or, you know, kind of tell him, okay, you take this tablet and you go and play games. It's a different, so how we use that technology.
Yeah, as a whole thing, if you kind of put it all together, we actually, there are, I mean, three skins you can really talk about. One is obviously your body, second is your clothes, and third is the architecture we're living around in. So it's our responsibility to make sure that we do it in the right way and the best way possible.
True.
And we have to cater to each one of them.
Yeah, absolutely. It may start small and close home, but yeah, as much as you can.
Yeah, and I think architecture is more psychology than design to a lot of extent.
Very true.
Yeah, it is. Definitely.
A lot of psychology.
Because I think when you're, if you're doing interiors, if you're doing houses, then you know you're actually handling people more than you're not handling space. So what do you talk about psychology in terms of how do you, I mean, give me three words where you actually can add the humor and make sure it makes sense to them.
I don't think humor is required, but yes, I think in short, if you just simply at every aspect believe in celebrating life, it should be more than enough.
Covers all the senses.
So celebrate life.
So feeling good, the feel good factor, yeah. Enjoy life, enjoy nature, what God has created. We have very less time for that appreciation of nature.
True.
Think we can be creative in a way where we find our individualistic needs, you know, and we fulfill them.
I just have nothing else to add apart from what all these wonderful people have
celebrate
said.
Life.
Just celebrate life, create magic.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, for me. Yeah. So I think for me,
join politics.
Not at all.
We need him. We need someone like him.
No, we need a movie.
Join your party.
No. I think I'll abide by John Lennon.
Okay.
Because I'm totally into music. I think bottom line is just to be happy, ensure everyone else is happy around us. I think that's what makes a huge difference.
Absolutely.
Yeah, for him, it was always happiness first.
Absolutely.
And that's where he started. Yeah.
So it's a small coffee table book which I had done. What do you call it as celebrate life? I call it as celebrate spaces. So
that's
very important because that's what we are here for.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Super. Yeah.
Fantastic. Thank you so much.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Wonderful.